One of those mornings where I have a theme in my heart, but God won't give me the specifics. I hate those mornings when you just pray and pray and pray, and you're like, God, what's on your heart? And he's like, I ain't telling you yet. And that, it happens from time to time. I really ask the Lord, and you press in, and you're just saying, God, what's on your heart? Because you got to preach to people that are a day in the Lord, and people that are 10 years in the Lord, and people that are maybe 50 years in the Lord. And that word is supposed to be relevant to everybody. And that's a challenging thing to do. It just has to be God. It has to be the anointing of the Holy Spirit and God revealing his word to people's hearts, or else it just doesn't work. Because there's nothing worse, there's few things worse than boring preaching. But when God rolls in or rests on a word, it's powerful. Yes. It's the opposite of boring. It's exciting, and it brings life and perspective and power. Mm-hmm. And so I'm going to pray really quick, and then we'll get right into it. Amen?
Amen.
Lord, don't humble me now. Amen. No, I'm just kidding. Father, I thank you that you are moving this morning, and your glory and presence is on each one of us. It's on this house. It's on this your people. And Lord, I pray that you quicken our ears to hear, and Lord, that you would use me this morning as your instrument, as your pen, to write by your Spirit on people's hearts. That they would be raised up, that they would be strengthened to receive an inheritance in your kingdom. In Jesus' name.
Yes.
Amen.
Amen.
As I was, we had baptism Sunday, last Sunday, and we baptized five guys. And it was an exciting thing, and there was life in the house, and new life in the house, and man, it was just awesome. I just love you, wifey. You're so beautiful. Oh, sorry. It was awesome. I just was looking at her, and I'm like, oh, she's so gorgeous. Sorry.
Make brownie points in your own time.
I won't deviate again.
Outside voice,
inside voice. Yes. And so I was sitting there just before the service started, and just waiting on the Lord. And we had a really, really great Sunday. And a couple people gave their hearts to Christ at the end of the service, and a couple young people. And that's always cool. And as I was waiting on the Lord, I just want to be real with you guys this morning and just kind of share my heart. It took me by surprise because the Lord whispered to me, spoke to me. Quietly, you know how the Lord speaks. And it was so God. And he said, son, you haven't even started this ministry yet. I'm like, what are you talking about, God? And he said, everything that up to this point has been preparation for what I'm about to do.
Yes.
And the reason I want to share that is because I feel like that's relevant to each one of us this morning. I feel like God is speaking to many of us this morning, if not all of us. Son, daughter, everything that you've gone through up to this point is preparation for what I'm about to do in your life. And that's one of the awesome things about God, the Father, about our Daddy God, our Heavenly God. He's so good. He uses everything. He will use everything. The good and the bad and the ugly, to sharpen us, to equip us, to give us perspective, to reach others, and to extend his kingdom. And that's just an awesome truth. And so I said, God, when are we starting? And he said, you're going to start June 1st. And I'm like, June 1st. And he gave me this kind of panoramic vision. It's a big thing. I'm not going to get into it right now. But it was just starting to show me what we would do as a ministry and the impact we would make, not just in this city, but other cities and this whole deal. And then he said, and he spoke to my heart last Sunday morning. He said, the next series I want you to preach just for May, I want you to preach a series called Shift. I want you to call it Shift, because my people have got to shift their perspective if they're going to walk in what I have for them in this next season. We can't afford to think as we've thought before. Amen? And we can't afford to do life as we've done it before. Something has to shift in our thinking and in our perspective. And when that begins to happen, our words begin to change, and then our actions begin to change. But it's always from the inside out. Always from the inside out. You know, in Matthew, I think it's Matthew 21 maybe, Jesus said, is talking to the Pharisees, who were the most religious people of the day. And he said, man, you guys, you're fools. You're hypocrites. He said, you cleanse the outside of the cup. You cleanse the outside of the dish. But the inside is full of skeletons and dead man's bones and rubbish and garbage. He said, why don't you be wise? Paraphrasing a little bit. But why don't you get a heart of wisdom? Why don't you clean the inside of the cup and dish? So then the outside will be clean too. Why don't you worry about what's on the inside? And I feel like sometimes there's so many of us, we struggle with issues of what people think about us and performance and all of these other things. And God is just saying, all through the night last night, this word was burning in my heart. God kept repeating over, even when I was sleeping, I just heard it reverberating in my spirit. And he was saying, it's Christ in you, the hope of glory. If you would begin to look at who lives on the inside of you, the Spirit of God, the anointing, Christ in you, the hope of glory, you would change. Some of that stuff that you've been struggling with would begin to break off. You would begin to be free in areas that you've never been free in before, as the power of God overtook you. And so I want to, when we talk about shift, there was literally part of the problem with this theme is that there's a lot of different areas that need to be addressed. But I want to just lay a foundation this morning, and then we're going to go deeper in a couple weeks. My darling wife is speaking next week on Mother's Day, so you don't want to miss that. That's going to be really good. She came up to me and said to me, it's Mother's Day coming up. She says, I'm speaking. I said, oh, really? She said, yeah, God told me. So it's not often that she pulls the God card on me. I kind of pull it all the time, but she pulled the God. I said, what are you speaking about? She said, I don't know. But God spoke to me, and I'm gonna give the message on Mother's Day. So you don't want to miss that. That's going to be next week. But after that, we'll continue our series for two more weeks before June 1st comes. I also want to quickly address, I grew up with a guy called Derek Schneider, who's made some serious impact all over the world, and he's one of the leading voices to young people and young adults in our generation today. A powerful, powerful man of God, and just an awesome minister, an awesome preacher, and I could go on and on and on. But he started this course called History Makers Training. And Carly and I were privileged enough to go in March, near the end of March, and it was powerful. One of the most, if not probably the most, life-changing 3 days of our lives. And we're still, the impact that we received in those 3.5 days is still unfolding in our lives. I think we're kind of wrecked. I mean, it was pretty intense. You got to read a book a day. You've got to, you realize what you can do. Like, I've it takes me a month to read a book. And here I am reading a book in a day. You lean into the supernatural power of God, and your weakness becomes his strength. And it's an awesome thing that begins to happen as you learn how to exercise your true potential. You know, we use about 5% of our brains on a regular basis. What if you were to increase that to 7? What if you were to increase it to 10? You know, your brain is so connected to your spirit, and God wants us to think. He wants us to systematize. He wants us to understand how things are going to happen and really begin to co-labor with him in a new dimension. So anyway, we're going to actually hold a training in September in Sarnia. Derek's going to come down with the team, and we're going to hold this training. It is a bit pricey. It's 3 days. in a hotel for 3 days and three nights. All your food is taken care of, the teaching sessions and whatever. It's about $385 for the entire 3.5 days. No, which isn't bad at all. It's actually probably worth a lot more than that, but it's not like these guys are getting paid big bucks. I mean, probably 200 of it covers the thing. So my advertising right now, a little bit. Why? Because I want you to enter your destiny, and I realize Sunday mornings are good, but there's not enough time to get you uncomfortable enough to start to press into the higher things of God on a Sunday morning. In fact, church has been kind of the opposite thing. In 2 weeks, I'm going to show a video, and some of you guys have probably seen it. There's this parody that this guy puts on. Look it up if you have a moment this week. Just Google, it's all about me, worship. And there's this guy, it's really funny, it's just a joke, but he's singing, he's on a piano, and he's singing, "It's all about me, Randy, and all this is for me, for your glory, and Lord, I lift my name on high," and he starts singing all these songs about him. It's funny, because that's often us, and our paradigm and our mindset of church. How many people have I heard, where do you go to that church? Well, I go because the kids program. I go to that church because they got great worship. I go to that church because I just love the preacher. He's just so awesome. Amen. Hallelujah. He's just so great. But what are you reciprocating? What are you giving? Any relationship that you're in that you give and you give and you give and you give, but you never receive anything back, that's an unhealthy relationship. And oftentimes we have this relationship with the church, this relationship with God, where we receive and receive and receive and receive and receive and receive. But if we're not giving something back, and I know that all of you you're in that place where you are giving back. And so your relationship with God is vibrant, it's increasing. And so, anyway, Derek is going to come and preach June 15th in this house. And so, this is a guy that's been all over the world, and just, but June 15th, mark that in your calendar. It's Sunday morning. And then we're going to have a pastors and leaders luncheon, and then we're going to try and get him to another place on Sunday night or something like that. But it's going to be a really, really great day. So, amen?
Amen.
Go to shift part one. Go to Hebrews 2, verse 10. And if you don't have your Bible because you're like trendy and I don't bring a Bible to church, y'all, because I'm cool. I don't need a Bible. I got it memorized. Right? Greg's got it memorized. Just encourage you guys. Hey, Angel, you just got a new Bible, didn't you? I heard about that.
But then
you forgot it. Guys, okay, I heard this a long time ago, but it's actually true. Going to church without a Bible is like going on a date without a woman.
Okay. It just, you do that all the
time. So Matt, you know exactly what I'm talking about. And so, I mean, if your husband has one, you can look on, and that's cool. You guys are one and everything. So where's your Bible, dear? Got it. All right. Hebrews chapter 2, verse 10. We'll have it up on the screen for you, too. Did you like that joke? My joke. You've heard it before. Hebrews 2, verse 10 says this. "For it was fitting that he," that's Jesus, "for whom and by whom all things exist, in bringing many sons to glory, should make the founder of their salvation perfect through suffering." Let's read that one more time. "For it was fitting that he, for whom and by whom all things exist, in bringing many sons to glory, should make the founder of their salvation perfect through suffering." Bringing many sons to glory. I want you to think about that statement for a minute as we go on. Turn down the scripture. What does that mean? Bringing many sons to glory. Bringing many sons to glory. Okay. Go to 2 Corinthians 3, verse 18. A couple pages over in the New Testament. We're a little bit wild, we're a little bit raw. You know, sometimes when you're preaching the word, you've got some, you know, and you craft the message, and it's really good. It's like you got some milk. The Bible talks about the milk of the word. The Bible also talks about the meat of the word. So I feel like this morning I'm just kind of tossing out steaks and stuff like that. And you're going to have to grab hold of it and just get, like, dig in with your heart. Really push into this morning. 2 Corinthians 3 and verse 18. We don't have time to get into all the context of the scripture this morning. We're just going after a theme. 1 Corinthians 3 verse 18 says, "And we all, everyone say all.
All.
Everyone say me. Because we all, that's me, that's you. We all, with unveiled face, beholding the glory of the Lord, are being transformed into the same image from one degree of glory to another. For this comes from the Lord, who is the Spirit."
Yeah.
Let's read that one more time. "And we all, with unveiled face, beholding the glory of the Lord, are being transformed into the same image from one degree of glory to another." Another version might say, we're being transformed from glory to glory.
Amen.
So from one degree of glory to another. "For this comes from the Lord, who is the Spirit." Who's the Lord? The Spirit. Who's God? Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Holy Spirit is God. He lives inside of you. And He's transforming you, or He wants to transform you, from one degree of glory to another. Amen? There's some verses in the Bible that in the original language, in the Greek, have a repetitive sense, which means it goes on and on. One of them is in John chapter 1, the Bible says, "And He gives us grace for grace," in John chapter 1. You know what that, it's in the repetitive sense in the Greek, and it actually means this. It means this, Matt. God gives you grace, and then He gives you more grace, and then when you need more, He gives you more, and then He gives you grace, and then He gives you grace, and then He gives you grace, and grace, and grace, and grace. And however much you need, however much you desire, He gives it to you. Grace for grace, for grace, for grace, for grace. And we all know, Matt, you need a lot of grace, brother.
Because he's married to me.
So. No. That's, he gave you grace. But there's other verses in the Bible that don't have the repetitive sense. It literally means it's two subjects we're talking about. Okay? So we're talking about, and here's my attempt, I'm going to write really neat. We're talking about going from one degree of glory to another degree of glory. This is the sense, and that's it. Glory to glory. From one degree, another. You know, it's been preached, I've heard many preachers saying, God is going to bring you from glory to glory to glory to glory to glory. And I grew up hearing, how many glories are there? I mean, we could go, I mean, one day we could be like God. Who knows how many glories there are? But that's actually not true. It's from one degree of glory to another degree. Now the question is, what is this glory? Go to Colossians. We're going to go to one more scripture. Sweet. Otherwise, I'd be teaching all morning. Because this is a big subject. This is pretty much the New Testament. Colossians 1. One more verse. Colossians chapter 1. Let's start in verse 24. I was going to go a little earlier, but let's start in 1 verse 24. 1 verse 24. Paul says, "Now I rejoice in my sufferings for your sake." Who here loves to suffer?
Woo!
Ah. Yeah. Oh, yeah. Come on, honestly, who here does not enjoy suffering? Pain, trials, tribulations, heartaches. Nobody enjoys suffering. But Paul's saying, he's not rejoicing because of the suffering. He's rejoicing because of the results of the suffering. He said, "For I rejoice in my sufferings." Why? For your sake. I rejoice in my sufferings for your sake. I rejoice in my sufferings for your sake. Paul the Apostle, the greatest example of a Christian in the whole of Scripture, in my opinion, arguably the greatest example of a Christian, says, "I'm filling up, I am suffering for you." Who here has ever been to a two-hour prayer meeting before? Some of us. Who here knows that a prayer meeting is not like church? Who here has ever God spoken to them before and said, "Go preach to that guy"? Ooh, and just something is challenged in you. I was at Tim Hortons yesterday, and I saw this table of youth, four young, you know, teenage kids, 16, 17. And this God was like, I could feel the conviction. He said, "Just go drop a word on them, give them a card for church, and tell them I love them." And I could feel it. I'm like, and I hadn't done that in a while, and when you haven't done something in a while, you kind of get out of practice, and, you know, like, I'm bold as a lion, and I got to remind myself, my heart starts beating really fast, like, and I'm thinking to myself, why am I scared right now? I mean, what are they going to do? I mean, what am I, why? Why am I scared? And I'm telling you, there's a trial, there's a tribulation, there's a suffering in that. When I walked up to them and I said, but once I did it, it was awesome. Paul rejoices in his sufferings. He says, "And in my flesh, I'm filling up what is lacking in Christ's afflictions for the sake of his body, that is the church." Lord, give us ears to hear this morning. "Of which I became a minister according to the stewardship, the grace from God that was given to me for you, to make the word of God fully known." Listen to this. Glue in with me right now. I want to make the word of God fully known. Look at this scripture. Everyone look this way. Verse 26. "The mystery hidden for ages and generations." The entire Old Testament, this mystery was hidden, but is now revealed to his saints. To them, God chose to make known how great among the Gentiles are the riches of the glory of this ministry. Everyone say glory.
Glory.
Okay? Just stop right there, James. To them, who? Us. The church. God has made known the riches of the glory of this ministry, of this New Testament covenant gospel that we preach, this ministry that we preach, Jesus Christ and him crucified, that Christ can live in you. Through the cross, you can receive forgiveness, and the Holy Spirit will come and dwell in you. No longer is the church a building, but the church is people that God fills. The church is not a physical building. This is church right now. We are the church. The Bible says your body is a temple of the Holy Spirit. You are the church. Everyone say, "I am the church."
Let's get
a little active in this place. I am the church.
I am the church.
You're the church.
Yes, what?
You're the one who's filled with God. Come on. You're filled with the Holy Spirit. Through what Jesus did on the cross, he accomplished eternal redemption for us, so that when we step into this grace and his presence steps into us, and we're baptized, we rise up eternal sons of God, never to be separated from the Father again. That's good news. That's the gospel. But I tell you, it's the beginning. It's only the start of what God wants to do.
Yeah.
He says, that mystery in you, what is the mystery? The riches of the glory of this ministry, which is Christ in you. Christ in you. The glory is Christ in you. But what is that glory? Christ in you is that glory. That's God. That is so glorious. We can't stop talking. We could talk for ages, and we'll talk forever about the glory of Christ in us. But Christ in us, as glorious as that is, it is the hope of glory. Christ in you is only the hope of glory. What is that second glory? See, this is a shift. This is the foundation. Laying a foundation. Where are we going as the church? Are we just going to rejoice forever about Christ in us, the hope of glory, while the world dies out there? What is this? Where are we going? What does God want to do? Has anyone ever thought that before? So then we have Paul. I won't go into any more scripture. I'm just going to talk for a few more minutes. Is that cool? I want to share with you. I've been waiting actually for 5-6 years to be able to share this message. I've never been released, Renee, to share. This is exciting. This has been percolating in me for years. And God's been teaching me this stuff. I haven't shared it, at least in this depth. I don't think. Maybe I have. I don't know. I don't remember ever teaching it. Maybe I touched on it or something. Paul and Barnabas, in Acts chapter 13, they were Christians for about 13 years at that point, and Paul was just going for it. And the Holy Spirit said, "Separate to me Paul and Barnabas for the work I have for them, the work of ministry." The Holy Spirit spoke to prophets and apostles, and they laid hands and fasted, and the Bible said they sent them out, and then it says, so Paul was sent by the Holy Spirit. That word sent in the Greek is so strong, it literally means pushed out, thrust forth. The Holy Spirit took Paul and just threw him out into what God had for him, into his ministry. And the Bible says they were first called Christians in Antioch, where Paul and Barnabas started their ministry. They started preaching and teaching, and this is what happened. Miracles started happening.
Yeah.
I tell you what happened with Paul. Miracles like Jesus. Mm-hmm. People being healed, the dead being raised, the gospel being preached, blind eyes opening, deaf ears opening, demons being cast out. And so, no longer were Paul and Barnabas just disciples or followers of Jesus. They looked at them and said, these guys, they look like Jesus. They're manifesting the very works of Jesus. There's power. Dunamis. Something is different about these guys. Probably some of them went, hey, miracles. Is Jesus raised from the dead? No, it's Paul and Barnabas. Well, let's call them little Jesus, little Christs. That's what Christian means, by the way. It means little Christ. Because the same miracles, the same power, the same grace that's flowing, that flowed in Jesus, is now flowing in them. So what is that second glory? Can we go to one more scripture? And then John 3. I'm not going to go to it. Just go to it, James. John 3. There's a man of the Pharisees named Nicodemus, a ruler of the Jews. This man came to Jesus by night, said to him, Rabbi, we know you are a teacher come from God, for no one can do these signs that you do unless God is with him. How did he know he's from God? Signs, wonders, miracles, power. Mark chapter 16, Jesus says, and go. Preach the gospel to every person. Those who believe will be saved. Those who disbelieve will be condemned. And these signs will follow those who believe. In my name, they will cast out devils. They'll speak in new languages. If they drink anything deadly, it will by no means harm them. We're in Canada right now, so we don't really worry about that in the 21st century. But back in the day, they worried about drinking deadly. You just didn't drink anything. Had to be clean water or wine or something that wasn't going to kill you.
In medieval times, they drank.
But anyway, if they drank deadly things that don't be harmed them, and the Bible says, you will lay hands on the sick and they will recover. What are those? Those are signs. Signs of what? That God is with you. How many Christians in Sarnia do we have running around doing signs in the name of Jesus? Jesus said, these signs will follow super apostles who fast 40 days.
No.
These signs will follow those who only have lived holy their whole lives and read 25 chapters a day. Then the signs will follow you.
Mm. No. These signs will follow those who believe.
The signs will follow those who believe. We know that you're from God because of these signs. Jesus answered and said to him, truly, truly, I say to you, unless one is born again, he cannot see the kingdom of God. What is that? Christ in you, the first glory, you become born again. And man, is it glorious, Mark. How glorious is it, Mark Fossey? Oh my God, when you become born again, it is so glorious. It is so awesome. No longer do I have to smoke dope to be happy. That was me at 16. If I didn't have a joint in my hand, I wasn't happy. If I didn't have a bottle in my hand, I was miserable. I needed substance. I had nothing in my life that would give me substance. But when I found Jesus, my life completely changed. And it was so glorious. It was so awesome. My life was transformed by the glory of God. Christ in me, I became born again. And you know what else happened? My perspective changed, Devon. My eyes were opened and I began to see. I began to feel things I've never felt before. I was like, oh my God, angel, there are angels around me right now.
Yeah.
I could feel God. I could sense angels. I could sense demons. I could sense another world. I could sense God, the Spirit. My spirit was awakened. I was born again. I was regenerated, the Bible calls it. I was new. In Christ Jesus, something shifted, something changed my life. But I didn't start running around doing miracles at that point. Just, I was new, it was exciting. And what happened? I was born again, and my eyes were opened, and now I can see the kingdom. And how many Christians do we have that can see the kingdom? If I laid hands on someone's back and said, be healed in Jesus' name, and his back's healed, most Christians would go, that was God. Hallelujah. Mm-hmm. We'd recognize it. We'd agree. Why? Because we're born again. Mm-hmm. Someone who's not born again would go, well, you know, that's the mental faculties of the higher regions of the cosmic universe at work. And
science.
No, really. I've been on the streets and I said, let me pray for your hand. They go, it's not going to work. I said, it'll work. In Jesus' name, be healed. Oh my God, it's healed. Well, you know what? That's the mental faculties and the universe aligned right there. And your brain power, you did that miracle. God, you did that. No, the kingdom came. When you're born again, you recognize it, you see it, you feel it. Nicodemus said to him, he didn't understand even this. Nicodemus the Pharisee, who was seeking God, how can a man be born when he is old? Can he enter a second time into his mother's womb and be born? Jesus is like, don't. You don't understand anything, Nick. Truly, truly, I say to you, unless one is born of water and the Spirit, he cannot enter the kingdom of God.
Yeah. Come on.
Enter the kingdom of God. What does that mean? It means you step into your authority and you begin to operate in the kingdom. And when you operate in the kingdom, I tell you, power happens, signs happen, wonders happen. People get healed. People get saved. People get touched. When you have an experience with God that brings you into that, he went on in verse 6, that which is born of flesh is flesh,
and that which is born is of spirit is spirit. Do not marvel that I said you must be born again. The wind blows where it wishes, and you hear its sound, but you do not know where it comes from or where it goes. So with everyone who is born of the Spirit. So what is this glory? This is a place. Okay, I'll go to one more verse. Go to just, I'm sorry, one more, last one, promise, for today. Romans 8. Just one verse. Just one verse. Romans 8. Go down all the way to like verse
19.
Keep going. For I consider, let's go to there. Verse 18. Two verses. For I consider that the sufferings of this present time are not worth comparing. You know what? Go up a one more verse. Okay. Go down to verse 15. You can't really preach the Bible without going reading the Bible, so whatever, we'll just read. For you did not, like, I don't know how, like, sometimes you can just use one verse and give some milk, but I said at the beginning, we're, like, throwing out steaks this morning, and I hope somebody gets something from this. For all who are led by the Spirit of God are sons of God. For you did not receive the spirit of slavery to fall back into fear, but you've received the spirit of adoption as sons by whom we cry, Abba, Father.
Yes.
The Spirit himself bears witness with our spirit that we are children of God. And if children, listen, if we're children of God, we're heirs.
Mm-hmm.
Carly? We're joint heirs with Christ. If heirs, heirs of God and fellow heirs with Christ, provided we suffer with him in order that we may be glorified together with him. This scripture challenges the North American Christian to the nth degree.
Yep.
To the nth degree. If I say to you, you can be born again, but unless you suffer with Jesus, you have no reward in him. This is such a challenging verse. What does that mean? What does suffering mean? It's a life of consecration. It's a life of obedience. It's not suffering. I'm not talking about suffering at the hand of the devil, sickness and disease. I'm not talking about that. I'm talking about suffering at the hand of God. And that's just for our glory. Why does he do that? So we'll bear fruit. For I consider that those sufferings, the sufferings of this present time, are not worth comparing with the glory that is to be revealed in us. For the creation waits with eager longing for the revealing of the sons of God. Revealing of sons. What is that? It's miracles. Signs. Wonders. Power. Miracles, signs, and wonders. Power. So how do we get there? We begin to stir ourselves up and have a passion for God that we've never had before. I'm telling you, churches only grow, movements only happen because people, they get sick and tired of being sick and tired. They get sick and tired of having no fruit in their lives.
Mm-hmm.
They get sick and tired of just feeling God's presence once a week or just, you know, once a day. They're saying, God, I long to bring impact to the world. And very soon, God will say to you, all right, begin to pray. It's the first thing that God will deal with you with. He'll say, you need to have a prayer life. You need to begin to pray.
Mm-hmm.
Begin to pray. What does that mean? Jesus said, he said, when you pray, go in your room when you've shut the door. Coming to corporate prayer is good, and I want everyone to come tonight. We would not fit in my house, but that'd be awesome.
Yeah.
6:30 to 8:30, every Sunday night we pray. Now, why did we have 3 people there last week out of 30 or 40 that were at church? You know why? Because when you pray, you've got to stir. Something's going to break inside of you. Something's going to give. You can't just go to a prayer. Like, you'll go to a prayer meeting and you will be dead bored if you don't participate. And the only way you participate is when you say, Holy Ghost, I can't even pray. I don't even know how to pray. What do you want me to say for 2 hours? And you begin to press into God.
at the end of it, you're tired. But you feel, man, we just broke through. We just accomplished something in the spirit. After you develop your relationship with God, you'll notice, you'll love Him. Something will shift. Okay, I'm getting into other messages. Let me just say this. I'm going to touch on some of these themes in the next 2 weeks I get to preach after Mother's Day. What we're lacking in the church in this day and age, and at least in North America, what we're lacking in the church, we're lacking the fear of God. Mm-hmm. What is the fear of God? It's not, I'm afraid of my dad. That's not what it is. The fear of God is a reverence for God.
Yeah.
It's a revealing. It's just an understanding. God is holy. He is holy. He is holy. He is awesome. And I don't have a choice. I submit to Him because He's my Lord. And the Bible says in the New Testament, perfect holiness in the fear of God. The Bible says, Solomon, the wisest person on earth, said, the fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom. The fear of the Lord is the beginning of knowledge. And we've lost. By and large, we've lost. If God speaks to us in this day and age as a Christian, it's usually optional. Well, God's spoken to me, but you know what? I don't know if I'll do it. I'll do it maybe later.
Wow. Right on.
And we've completely lost the fear of God in our lives because we don't understand who He is. He only holds the universe in His hand. I mean, if He would bow down and partake of the humble things of heaven and earth and speak to you, that ought to be the greatest privilege that you would ever have in this life, is to obey a command from God Almighty. But we're like, well, maybe later, God. Completely lost it. We've lost a foundation in the Word. Many believers, many young people, they don't read their Bible. Some of us in here, your Bible just collects dust. You've lost the found. You've lost the Word. I tell you, I stand on this Word. This Word is my life. I read my Bible and I pray. Because the Word is the foundation. The Word of God is the foundation of this church. This church does not exist unless God spoke to this man and said, start a church. And what, oh Lord, what do you want to call it? Dunamis. This is God's church. This church is foundationalized on the Word of God, and the Word of God is what's growing it. The Word of God is what's growing you. We lost that. How do we return to God? We return to the Bible. We return to His Word. We return to His laws. We return to His covenant. We return to His rules. We return to Him. His principles, His ways, His integrity, His integrous ways that He's commanded us to do life. Don't have sex before you're married. Why? Because God wants to ruin your fun? No, because God wants you to have more fun.
That's right.
He doesn't want your heart to get broken a bunch of times before you get married. If your heart's already been broken, He wants to heal it up, and He says, well, separate yourself now.
Yeah.
Why? Why does God say, treat your body as a temple of the Holy Spirit? Why can't I can't smoke dope? I can't do this. I can't do that. Well, you can, but it's not good for you. And God wants things that are good for you. That's why He says those things. And some of those things are suffering a little bit. That's what God talks about sometimes. I stand on the Word.
Isaiah 64, verse 6.
I don't know what it says.
But we're all as an unclean thing, and all our righteousness as our filthy.
Before
righteous.
Christ, that's how we were. But it's all good. Thank you. Our righteousness is as filthy rags. You know what else we've lacked? I got to finish. But we've lacked an empowerment of the Holy Spirit. Mm-hmm. We've lacked the knowledge of how to love God the Father. You know, angel, loving God is a choice. Mm-hmm. When you might, tomorrow you might wake up and you don't feel that you love God. It doesn't matter. You get to choose to love God.
That's right.
Just like I get to choose to love my wife gets to choose to love, I get to choose to love my friend, I get to choose who I love. Why? Because love is action. You know how I love God? Often, I just look to Him. I say to Him, God, I love you. Mm-hmm. I adore you. And you know what I feel? His presence. Just, I feel his presence.
Yeah.
And you know what he says? He says, I love you too. I adore you more than you'll ever know. Okay. Loving God. Loving the Father. Do you know that the Father loves you? We're closing on 40 minutes here. 50 minutes. My gosh, I got it up. There's other things, but that we need to shift our mindset. Is this helping anyone?
Yeah.
Amen.
So we have got to be a church that presses in, that presses forward, that presses and presses and presses and presses and presses into the higher things of the Spirit of God, into the power of God.
Yeah.
I challenge everybody in this place to begin to seek God like never before.
Yeah.
And begin to know him like never before.
Yeah.
Because he'll talk to you and he'll begin to give you dreams and visions.
Yeah.
Big D, it's time for you, brother.
Yeah.
To enter the calling of God for your life. Listen, look up at me. To work with a diligence and a fire that you've never, even in your job, in your career, in what God has for you. To begin to work like never before. To begin to push yourself to the limit of who I am as a creationist, who I am as a graphic designer, who I am in my gifting and my talent. Because when we begin to push in, we'll see results. Amen. Is there anyone here that needs to get born again today? Just put up your hand. I'm not born again. I don't even know God. And we'll pray with you right now. Is that anyone here today? All right. Two of you. Okay.
Awesome.
Let's do this. Just everyone here, close your eyes. Angel and what is it, Brett?
Jeff,
close your eyes. Two people are receiving Christ.
Yes.
Hallelujah.
I want everyone to pray with me. Just pray this. Just close your eyes. And from your heart, pray this. Lord Jesus.
Lord Jesus.
I'm a sinner. And I need your grace.
Thank you.
For dying on the cross for my sin.
For dying
for my shame.
For dying for my
sickness.
And Father, right now,
I receive the gift of your Son,
Jesus Christ.
I receive the grace of God.
Lord, come into my life.
Be the Lord of my life.
Be the master of my life.
I want to live for you.
Fill me with your Spirit.
Thank you that I'm born again
by the power of your Spirit.
And right now,
I
am reconnected to you. I am reconciled to you through the death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus Christ. Amen. Now clap your hands, church.